Hello, everybody. Thanks for the invitation. It has been a few months, actually. And we'll talk today about seizures and status, so something that is very close to my heart. It's an interesting topic, because as you're going to see, you have these patients in the unit. So let's start with a case, and this is a real patient in the neuro ICU, 53, in status, loaded with levetiracetam and 2 milligrams of lorazepam in the ER. This gentleman had a history of post-traumatic epilepsy after he was beaten up in the past, and he had also a UTI with the ESBL E. coli last month, and then he had epididymitis 10 days ago. So these are the home meds: gabapentin, valproic, citalopram, ertapenem, and risperidone. And this is the old CAT scan from 2007 when he was beaten up. You can see the contusion here, had a craniectomy actually. And then the current CAT scan, where it shows the encephalopathy, encephalomalacia that he had over there. So the old contusion in that situation. So anybody, what's the probable cause of the status? If you don't, we can continue and then we'll discuss that later on. But anybody has any idea? Any guess? I don't know if Dr. Mehta knows, because probably she remembers. Right. So obviously he has epilepsy. Why is he now in status? I mean, that's the major question. So let's start by talking a little bit about generally about seizures in the ICU. And as you can see, we don't have too many data about that in the ICUs. There are some old studies, this one by Tom Black, and it showed that the 12% of patients who come to the medical ICU or to general ICUs admitted for non-neurological events, 28.1% of them develop seizures. So if you multiply 12 by 28.1, you have 3.4%. So one out of 30 patients in the medical ICU, in your unit, may develop seizures at some point. So it's not very rare, it's not very common, but it depends also on how you look at it. So if you compare this, if you look at these patients with continuous EEG, as you can see from Columbia, in the ICUs, general ICUs, not neuro ICU, 19% of them had seizures, and out of these 19%, 92%, so 17.5% of them, had non-convulsive seizures, ladies and gentlemen. So the vast majority of these patients in general ICUs had seizures that you could not detect without a continuous EEG. And this is another study from a medical ICU, and they did again continuous EEG in these patients, and as you can see, 60% of these patients had sepsis. I'm sure you have the same thing. And then when they did the continuous EEG, they found out that 10% of them had electrographic seizures, so non-convulsive seizures, and out of, 10% of them had electrographic seizures, and 6.7% in essence, of them had non-convulsive seizures only. So there was no convulsive component in these patients, and then there was another 17% that had periodic epileptic discharges, so PLEDs. So if your brain right now has PLEDs, believe me, you won't be able to communicate very, very well. So again, you can have somebody who's confused, encephalopathic in the ICU, in the medical ICU, septic, because sepsis actually was an independent variable that predicted electrographic seizures. And you don't know that because they are septic, they are hypotensive, they are febrile. But if you do a continuous EEG, maybe you can find something. So is the cause of seizures in the ICU the same as in the general ward? Not necessarily, because you can have the same pathology from the brain. So you can have strokes, infections, tumors, inflammations, trauma. But you have also in the ICUs, also the ICU, the critical care illness. And you can have hypoxia, ischemia, as you know, post-cardiac arrest, infection, fever, or sepsis. And then medications. A large percentage of these patients or etiologies for these patients is medications. And then you can have also the metabolic dysfunction, the organ dysfunction of these patients. So I'm showing you this study because it showed that in two New York hospitals, 33% of all these patients were in the ICU, so not all ICU patients, But the metabolic abnormality was in 25%, and these patients had, actually 25% of them had multiple seizures, not only one seizure. So it's not uncommon. And this is an old study that we published a few years ago, and in essence, we compare non-ICU patients with ICU patients with emergent EEG, so when you call them within 1 hour, and you can see that there was a significant difference in the non-ICU patients had more strokes compared to the ICU, and then the ICU patients had more trauma, of course, and post-cardiac arrest. Nothing surprises me there. But if you look at the EEG results, you'll find out that more patients in the non-ICU environment had normal EEG, and then they had interictal epileptiform discharges, PLEDs. And then the patients who were in the ICU, of course, had more convulsive status and generalized slowing, okay, as expected and as is our experience. So if you call for an EEG, an emergent EEG, and you do it, believe me, you have pretty good chances in the ICU to find just a generalized slowing, and you say, well, that's useless. It's not, and I'll prove it to you. So is the clinical presentation of seizures or epilepsy in the critical care the same as in the general hospital or ward? So, yeah, I mean, seizures, everybody knows, are hypersynchronous discharges, cortical discharges, but you have in the ICU also other phenomena. You can have posturing, okay? You can have myoclonus. You can have tics, tremor, asterixis, clonus, chorea, hemibalismus, if you want, shivering, very common. Or you can have a transient loss of consciousness secondary to syncope or to arrhythmias. And then you can have the apneas, the psychogenic non-epileptic form attacks. And I'll show you some slides. And in all this confusion, obviously the International League Against Epilepsy adds more, because this is the definition that they have. And read it, and if you understand it, let me know. One unprovoked seizure and probability of further seizures similar to the general recurrence risk, more than 6% after two seizures occurring over the next 10 years. This is... The definition that they have. So I'll stop it for a second here, and then I'll try to put the video. Should I do something?
No, that's okay, fine.
Yeah, it's, so this is a patient who was in the medical ICU, and has these movements there. I don't know if you remember this patient, but you transferred this patient to us at some point. So who agrees that these are seizures? Tonic-clonic seizures. Smart people, I mean, they say, well, you know, in order to show us and asking us this question, probably these are not seizures. And that's true, because with continuous EEG, these were not seizures. This is a patient with an NMDA receptor encephalitis, actually the first one that we ever had in diagnosis. But look, I mean, they look like seizures. Very nice. All right? So, what's shaking in the ICU? So, they did the study. Vijayam actually did his residency here a long, long time ago. I don't know if Dr. Bowles remember him. But he had, as you can see, patients, 52 events in ICU setting. Only 31% of them were in the neuro ICU. And as you can see, the majority of these clinical events that we didn't know if they were seizures or not, the majority, 73%, were not seizures. They were tremors, myoclonic jerks, etc. And actually, 3.8% were non-epileptic psychogenic seizures. 3.8%. So, again, bottom line is the majority of these movements that you see in the unit may not be seizures. All right, how do they present? I'm not showing you this to tell you that we have generalized tonic-clonic seizures or partial seizures or complex partial seizures, but I'm showing you this to show you the non-convulsive seizures. How common are they? And they are common, and they present as a change of mental status. They present as speech or motor arrest. Sometimes you have a very mild nystagmus or lid twitching. And these are numbers, and I'll show you a very nice slide that was developed by one of our residents. Actually, at that time, he was not even a resident. He was a pre-resident. He was working at Yale with Larry Hirsch. And in essence, it divides into children and divides into adults. And you have the incidence of non-convulsive seizures in prospective and retrospective studies. And as you can see, there's a difference between, let's say, the ischemic stroke has a very low incidence of seizures, as you can see, probably less than 10%, probably 5%. And then the bleeds have much higher, TBI much higher, tumors much higher. I like this slide because visually it gives you an idea where how common these things are. So they are common. So what about continuous EEG monitoring? Is it another toy for critical care setting with questionable value? Is it a 30-minute routine or spot EEG, as we call it sometimes, enough to detect seizures? So, well, you know, I'm showing you this slide to show you that the continuous EEG monitoring utilization has increased over the last, between 2005 and 2009 by 264%. So this is something that people are using more and more and more because they are learning that you need something longer than the 20, 30 minutes of plain routine spot EEG, whatever you want to call it. And if you look at these results, the continuous EEG was an independent predictor, actually, of reduced mortality and had nothing to do with the length of stay in the charges. But as you can see, when you have a continuous EEG, you have higher charges compared to the other ones, the spot EEG, and these patients stay a little bit longer in the ICU, but not significantly. So, yes, we see this more and more. So this is a study from Mayo. And I'm showing you this just to give you an idea how much better it is compared to plain routine EEG. So they did a routine EEG, and immediately after that, they hooked the patient to a continuous EEG for a minimum of 30 minutes. And look what they found. So clinical events that they recorded, you know, real convulsive seizures and electrographic seizures, 20%, 21%, and 11%. On the video continuous EEG, when they did that, this doubled from 21 to 40 and from 11 to 26.7%. So if you do just a routine EEG compared to a continuous EEG, you have probably half the chances to find an epileptic phenomenon. So it answers the question. And here, actually, the non-epileptic were 9.5%. So this is a very important slide. And why you need a continuous EEG? And why it should be the standard? Because the absence of motor phenomena is misleading. So if you have patients who were in convulsive status and they stop seizing, they stop convulsing, and you hook them to a continuous EEG, you'll find that 48% of them were in had non-convulsive seizures after they finished the convulsions. So if you treat somebody and he stops shaking, and you say, oh, I treated the patient, he's fine, that doesn't count. Because, you know, if you do the EEG, you'll find that a large percentage of these patients may have non-convulsive seizures in their brain. What about the level of consciousness? This classical teaching that you have a non-convulsive seizure, you're in the ER, and they give you a bit lorazepam, and the patient wakes up, and you say, oh, he was in non-convulsive status. It doesn't count like that. It doesn't work like that. Because this is from the Treiman study. After treating successfully these patients, 67% of patients with convulsive status and 100% of patients with non-convulsive status were comatose, still comatose, 12 hours after this. So this idea that you give a bit lorazepam and the patient wakes up and leaves the hospital doesn't work. So neither the motor phenomena nor the level of consciousness is very helpful to you to decide if this patient is having seizures or not. You need to have a continuous EEG in order to detect this. So this is also a beautiful slide from Colombia. Dr. Mayo is not here, but this is from his group at that time. So he divided these patients in convulsive and non-convulsive and by time. So they did the continuous EEG, and they divided the incidence or the yield of seizures that they had based on how long this continuous EEG was done. So as you can see, at the start of the EEG, they had 15% of them were in essence non-convulsive. They had non-convulsive seizures and a small percentage convulsive seizures. In 1 hour, 56%. So the plain EEG, the routine EEG is half an hour. So it's somewhere between 15 and 56%. So it may capture probably somewhere over here. All right? But look, for non-comatose patients, in order to capture 86% of seizures, you needed continuous EEG for 1 to 6 hours. For comatose patients, in order to have the same percentage, around 86-87%, you needed 24 to 48 hours. So bottom line is that if you have a comatose patient in the ICU, you need longer period of continuous EEG, up to 48 hours, up to 2 days, in order to capture seizures with a chance of 87%. All right? So if you do a continuous EEG in a comatose patient, even up to 12 hours, let's say from morning to the evening, it's not going to be enough. For non-comatose patients, yeah, you can capture it even within 6 hours. So remember that, because that's important to remember. And okay, all right, you do the continuous EEG and you find seizures or you don't find seizures. Is it helpful to you? Yes, it is, because if you look at these are patients who were not receiving anti-epileptic medications prior to the study, and 14% of them started anti-epileptic medication because they found seizures on the continuous EEG, and then another 33% changed the anti-epileptics, either increased or decreased the dose, and then another 5% they stopped the anti-epileptics based on the results of the continuous EEG. So if you add them all together, in half of the studies, there was a change in the management of the patient. So it is important to have it. And these are the indications for the American Clinical Neurophysiology Society. And as you can see, yeah, if you have a persistent alteration of mental status following a convulsive status epilepticus or in association with acute supratentorial brain injury, or you have periodic discharges on the routine or emergent EEG, or if you can paralyze or, the patients or sedate them with non-general anesthetics, like fentanyl, for instance, these patients, yeah, these patients maybe have electrographic seizures and you won't know. Now, if you put them on midazolam, that's a different story. All right, so again, these are the indications for continuous EEG if you want to follow the good society. So, all right, fine. And non-convulsive seizures, are they benign? I mean, the patient is not seizing. The pH doesn't go down to the 6s, and the PCO2 doesn't go up to the 80s, and the oxygenation, they don't desaturate. Just the brain is firing. Is that important? Should be treated. So this is also another study from Colombia by Jan Klassen, and it shows you they had surface EEG. So this is contralateral surface EEG to the focus, and then you have ipsilateral, which is this one, and then they had depth electrodes, so electrocorticography. And as you can see, first thing is that you start seeing the seizure starting way before you can detect it on the surface EEG. This is a spectrogram. So it starts over here. The other ones pick it up a little bit later on. And as you can see, the heart rate goes up, the blood pressure goes up, the perfusion pressure goes up, the ICP goes up during this period of time, and then the partial brain oxygenation, the PBTO2, goes down during that period of time. So these were not convulsive seizures. So it's not benign. The brain sees it and feels it. And this is another one from UCLA, from Paul Vespa, in TBI, severe TBI patients, and they had 61.8% of them, of these patients that they had, with macrodialysis and depth electrodes, 61%, 62% of them had electrographic seizures, not convulsive seizures, electrographic, just non-convulsive seizures. And look what happens. When you have these electrographic seizures, which is the gray zone, the gray bar here, then the glucose goes down and the lactate pyruvate ratio, which shows you obviously what? Anaerobic metabolism goes up. All right? So during that period of time, when you have these non-convulsive electrographic seizures only, the brain feels that. You have anaerobic metabolism, you have utilization of the glucose, so you have a metabolic crisis in these patients. So, bottom line is, yes, the data that we have so far show that they are not benign. They are not. So, how are we going to treat these seizures? The goals in the ICU is to stop, of course, the ictal activity and then prevent recurrence and avoidance escalation to really status epilepticus and then prevent and treat the complication that you can have from that. And, of course, as we strongly believe, one size does not fit all. Okay? It does not. So you need to individualize your treatment in these patients. So I will give you a potpourri of diagnoses. Some of them you have in the medical ICU, some of them you don't. But just to give you some idea. So the first thing is prophylactic anti-epileptic medications. So this is a nice table based on recommendation and guidelines. Should we treat prophylactically somebody who has never had seizures, okay, but come with TBI, with traumatic brain injury, only for 7 days? That's at least the guidelines. What about ischemic stroke? Not recommended. So if you have somebody who has an MCA stroke and ends up in the medical ICU, don't give him or her levetiracetam. ICH, they are no evidence, and there is no recommendation. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, only for the first 3 days. You know, this is the period that you expect the neurosurgeons or the neurovascular neurointerventional radiologist to coil or clip the aneurysm. So you need to protect them, because obviously you won't like to have a patient who's seizing and with an unprotected aneurysm ready to blow again. What about brain tumors? Again, not recommended. Okay, it's interesting because this, as you can see, are older guidelines and they are defunct right now. So the American Academy of Neurology is having a task group that is looking again to revise these guidelines. So they are not recommended. So if you have somebody who didn't have any seizures, don't give them anti-epileptic medication, despite the fact that they may have a brain tumor. So very, very quickly, TBI, intermediate risk or I would say low intermediate risk. The most important thing for you to remember is that you can have seizures early on or immediately. You bump your head and you have a seizure. Doesn't count, it's not important. Or you can have late seizures. If you have a seizure 1 week later, that's a risk for having epilepsy, have recurrence after that, 90% of them. So the early seizures after trauma and after stroke and after hemorrhage of any kind doesn't count necessarily regarding prognosis, right? Because one of the major questions is obviously if I have a certain injury to my brain, I'm going to become epileptic. So this doesn't count. But if you have a seizure that happens later on when you develop, when things cool down and you develop cerebral cicatrices in the cortex, that gives you epilepsy. So you need to cover these patients with anti-epileptic medications. I'm going to skip that for the time, sake of the time. But it shows, you know, patients who have acute subdural hematoma, this group here, compared to chronic hematoma. As you can see, the incidence is much higher when you have an acute hematoma, early seizures, compared to a chronic hematoma. But, you know, 10% is 10%. All right? One out of 10 of them may have seizures with a chronic subdural hematoma. And these are the variables, actually, that were associated in this study. It's meta-analysis. With acute subdural and with chronic subdural. So if you have somebody who's alcoholic or using alcohol, you have 14.3% chances to have seizures if you have a chronic subdural hematoma. Not uncommon at all. We see it all the time. If you have somebody who has who has GCS less than 9, 24 hours after surgery of the acute subdural hematoma, then he has pretty good chances actually to have seizures. Craniotomy. Or preoperative GCS, so if the patient is comatose, 3.1%, three times higher. All right, stroke, ischemic stroke. So I'm showing you this just to show you the instance of seizures. There are two peaks in life. One is early on, babies and children, and then there is a late one, and in the middle there is a you. So early in life and late in life, you can have seizures. And because late in life you have much more strokes, like this one and that one, then you have probably around 50% chances of all the seizures in later life in elderly patients are due to stroke. Okay. So for ischemic stroke, again, early seizures or late seizures, depending on where you put the cutoff. Important thing for you to remember is that if somebody comes in status epilepticus, which is rare, if the status epilepticus was the first symptom, he presents in status after an ischemic stroke, then there is usually no recurrence. But if you have status epilepticus after early or late seizures, the same idea that I told you before about trauma, then this status may recur later on. Maybe you are developing epilepsy, and you should be much more careful with these patients. And I'm showing you this slide again to show you that, you know, this is from Cincinnati, as you can see. It's not very high, 2.4% had seizures during the first 24 hours. And the highest incidence actually was with cardioembolism. So if you have somebody with AFib and has an ischemic stroke, has more chances actually to develop seizures than if you have a small or large, a small lacune, for instance, or a large vessel occlusion in these patients. And I'm showing you this slide also just to talk a little bit about the stroke mimics. So you have somebody who presents in the ER with an acute deficit, and everybody thinks that has a stroke. And you do all the whole workup, and you find out that there is no stroke. So you call it stroke mimic. So seizures actually were either the first or second most common etiology for stroke mimics, as you can see, anywhere between 11.5 to 71%, broad range. And also in studies where the patients had received TPA, the same thing. I mean, seizures comprised probably half to two-thirds of these patients. And what happens if you give TPA in somebody who had a seizure instead of a real stroke? Nothing happens. Usually these patients do well. But again, you know, it's not that TPA is a drug without any side effects. You can have angioedema, or you can have a bleeding ulcer that you didn't know, and you start bleeding from that, and then you need 5 liters of transfusion. So, again, not all strokes are strokes. Some of them are seizures, and they present with TOTS paralysis. So keep it in your mind. And actually, as you can see, they present with generalized or secondary generalized seizures, 50%, around 50% of them. So how are you going to treat them? Usually, you need only one drug to stop the seizures. And there are some advantages and some disadvantages of some drugs. So for instance, there are some data about topiramate, carbamazepine, and valproic acid that they may have additional neuroprotective properties and neuroregenerative properties in patients with cerebral ischemia. On the other hand, if you have phenytoin, benzodiazepines, and barbiturates, these drugs may impair recovery. So they are not good drugs for rehabilitation. And the other thing is that you have also the enzyme inducers, especially carbamazepine and phenytoin, and these reduce the levels of statins. So you have patients who have an ischemic stroke, and you put them on statins for secondary stroke prevention, and then the effect of these drugs to the statins is bad. So bottom line is that if you have to decide to use antiepileptics, don't use the inducers in patients who are on statins after ischemic stroke. So these are the recommendations from the International League Against Epilepsy. And as you can see, these are the drugs of first-line monotherapy in adults, carbamazepine, levetiracetam, phenytoin, and zonisamide. And then in elderly adults, you're not going to use phenytoin, but you're going to use lamotrigine or gabapentin. And there are some studies, actually, that used gabapentin, 900 milligrams a day. You can divide into 3 doses, usually. And, you know, they decrease the seizures significantly. Or levetiracetam, more or less the same percentage. So these are 2 acceptable drugs to use as monotherapy for these patients. Again, not FDA approved for this specific indication. What about ICH, intracerebral hemorrhage? Again, I'm showing you this because if you look at this patient with continuous EEG, you'll find out that 28% of these patients had seizures, and 21% of these patients had non-convulsive seizures. Right, so 76% of these patients had non-convulsive seizures. So it's not uncommon at all. And another one from Colombia, again by Dr. Myers' group, again the same idea. And these are the patients who had the subgroup of patients who had more chances, more risk for having seizures. If you have a lobar ICH, you have many more chances because it's close to the cortex to have seizures than if you have, let's say, a thalamic ICH or a basal ganglia ICH. So if you get a CAT scan and you see somebody who has a bleed in the surface of the brain and not in the posterior fossa, not in the cerebellum, then this patient has probably more chances of having seizures than somebody who has deep inside the brain. seizures post-subarachnoid hemorrhage, as you can see, 12% of them in this large series of subarachnoid hemorrhage. And they calculate the seizure burden in this patient. So this was the total amount of recorded time of patient seizing on a continuous EEG in hours. And what it shows is that the higher the burden, this is the burden, the higher the burden, the worse the ranking. So 4 to 6 means dependent living or death. 6 is death. And then the cognitive outcomes of this patient also goes down. So the longer you have seizures in these patients, the worse the cognition eventually, and the highest the disability and mortality in these patients. So they are not benign. Again, this one to show you that if you do surface EEG, then you can detect seizures in 8%. If you do intracortical recording, then you can pick up this, 4 times more. All right? Brain tumors. So there are pros and cons about, as I told you before, but the guidelines say no, don't cover them with antiepileptics if they don't have seizures. If they have seizures, of course, you're going to treat them like anybody else. And the reason, actually, that people believe that we should not give antiepileptic medication in these patients is that they have many interactions with other important drugs. So they interact with steroids, they interact with chemotherapy, and they increase the risk for photosensitivity and rashes in patients who have radiation. Nobody knows why this is happening with phenytoin and valproic, in fact. But if you get radiation in this patient, you are on these two antiepileptic medications, then the risk for having photosensitivity or rashes from that, which are around 3%, increases up to almost 10%. So if you have a brain tumor patient, is there any advantage to use one or the other antiepileptic medication? So this is a study that they used in glioblastoma multiforme. They used antiepileptic medication. Some of them were on antiepileptic medication. Some of them were not on antiepileptic medications. And they treated them with temozolomide. In essence, they found that if these patients were on valproic acid, they survived a little bit longer. And the idea behind it is that the valproic is an inhibitor, and it was inhibiting the metabolism of temozolomide, so maybe they had higher levels of temozolomide in these patients, and that's why they survived a little bit longer. So if you want to use an antiepileptic medication because the patient is seizing and has a brain tumor, probably you should use something that is not hepatically metabolized and affecting your enzymes. So good ones would be renally excreted medications like levetiracetam, gabapentin, and then obviously valproic acid. So what about medications? Can they give you seizures? So look at that, bupropion, diphenhydramine, tricyclic antidepressants, isoniazide, 6%. So antibiotics, we use them every day in the ICU, every single day. So I divide into penicillins, carbapenems, cephalosporins, and fluoroquinolones, and then as you go down, you have higher chances for seizures. And as you can see, penicillin G has the highest risk for seizures. Actually, this is the way that you do in animals. You take the little mouse, you make a little hole, and you put a drop of penicillin in the cortex, and the little mouse starts seizing. But look at cephalosporins. Do you know this drug? Are you using it in the medical ICU? You know, not at all. In Ipenem, there are some studies that showed actually that do have it in the hospital. Are we using it still, or it's kind of defunct? Probably not. But it was giving you around 6% of seizures, 6% seizures. And then the fluoroquinolones, again, you know, as you can see, ciprofloxacin and moxi are in the middle. So this is a nice and interesting one, and I'm telling the fellows and the residents all the time, because they had continuous EEG and they were infusing the cefepime and then the meropenem. And during the infusion, so at the peak level of the drug, 24% of these patients on cefepime had interictal or ictal activity on the EEG, and only almost 4% on meropenem. So this one actually was giving you during the peak infusion, peak levels, it was giving you probably what? 6 times higher risk for seizures. So if I have to choose between the two, probably I will use this one. But you know that we cannot use it all the time. What about antipsychotics and antidepressants? SSRIs are low risk, so don't be scared about them. But if you have somebody who is on this one, especially bupropion, this increases the risk for seizures. Okay, and the same thing with antipsychotics. Haloperidol and flufenazine and this risperidone are kind of low risk, and then clozapine and clomipramazine, which nobody is using these days, I guess, but I don't see them anymore. High risk for seizures. So in our case, here, so this is the patient. Came on valproic acid. Initially, they had a level that was on before the admission. The admission happened on the 3rd. Less than a week earlier, or maybe a week earlier, the free level of valproic was 17. Okay, perfect. So he was not seizing at that time, and he was getting 500 TID. And then he comes, and the total level on admission is 4. So they gave him two grams of valproic, and they started him again, continue the valproic IV this time, not PO. And then nothing happens. Less than one, again another loading dose, nothing happens, and then another loading dose. What happened actually here, the level started going up. So ertapenem was started here, and then ertapenem was stopped here, and the levels did go up. All right? So carbapenems affect the valproic acid level, and amongst them, the imipenem probably doesn't affect it so much, but the ertapenem and meropenem actually affect it more than this. So keep it in your mind, because these are antibiotics, especially ertapenem these days, that we're using all the time in the ICU. And this is another one that shows again the same thing. You had somebody who had good levels of valproic acid, and then they started the ertapenem here, and then despite the fact that they were giving more and more and more higher doses, the levels were going down. So you need to know that. What about electrolytes? Hyponatremia. Yeah, I mean, it can give you seizures, but if you, this is a nice study, because if you compare to, let's say, a level of 120 to 124, you can see that if the level of sodium is, this is the reference, if the level of sodium is less than 110, it gives you, what, it gives you 18 times more chances for having seizures than if you are, let's say, 120 to 124. So very severe hyponatremia, yes. And the treatment for that, obviously, would be what? Not to give phenytoin in these patients or levetiracetam, is to try to correct the sodium. And how are you going to do it? I mean, if the sodium is chronically low, usually does not give you seizures. If there's an acute drop of the sodium, that's the risk for seizures, acute hyponatremia, not chronic. So if you correct it too fast, obviously, in a chronic hyponatremic patient, you increase the risk for osmotic demyelination, or CPM, as we're calling it before. And there are different guidelines about how fast you can correct it. What about glucose? Well, you know, if you have a ketotic hyperosmolar coma, that gives you fewer seizures, fewer chances, lower risk for seizures than if you have a non-ketotic hyperosmolar. And the interesting thing with the non-ketotic hyperglycemic coma is that the seizures that you can have, they can present like strokes, kind of. So they are usually partial seizures. They can be present as speech arrest, visual changes. In the ICU, difficult necessarily. It's not easy to detect this. But maybe the patient will tell you. All these so-called reflex seizures, when you move a limb and this limb starts seizing, convulsive, and then there's a refractory period when this stops and you cannot reproduce it. But if you do an EEG, obviously you will be able to pick it up. So obviously the treatment there would be what? Rehydration, electrolytes, and then insulin, and avoid the phenytoin because it decreases the insulin secretion, something that people don't know very well. What about if you have hypoglycemia? Well, that's sine qua non. Everybody knows that this is bad for your brain. And so which one is worse? You think the low glucose or the high glucose? Obviously the low glucose, right? So how are you going to treat the seizures? That's the bottom line. So if you have a brief seizure, everybody would be excited. Even in our unit that we have seizures all the time, the nurses will come and say, he's seizing. So you go there, and again, you know, by the time you go to the bed, the patient has stopped seizing. So this was a brief seizure, less than 60 seconds. So what would be your goal in this situation? Obviously observe, eliminate etiology. If the patient had never had seizures before and has a brain tumor, it's different, or if he has now he's not waking up after that, obviously he needs a CT of the head. So you can consider loading them with anti-epileptic medications, and the loading dose for phenytoin obviously is 18 to 20 milligrams per kilogram, or fosphenytoin if you want, or you can use valproic acid in phenytoin intolerant allergic patients, for instance, or you can use, you can go slower and you can give it through through the mouth or through an OG tube or an NG tube, or you can use levetiracetam. Okay, all these are options. And then obviously we can pad the bed rails and then increase the alertness for having more seizures. You know, you need to watch these patients, and then obviously call for an EEG at some point. And obviously some neuroimaging study if the patient had never had this before. And there is no obvious hypoglycemia, for instance, obvious etiology. What about if the seizure is a little bit more prolonged? You go there and the patient is seizing, and you tell them, go get the lorazepam from the Pixis, and the patient is still seizing. Well, you can use, first line of defense is to use benzos, since the trial study in the 90s. So lorazepam, and the dose is 0.07 to 0.1 milligram per kilogram. So if you have somebody who is, let's say, 70 kilos, clearly not an easy patient, then you can use probably 5 milligrams to 7 milligrams in this patient. Are you going to give it all together? We had a neurosurgical chief resident once upon a time that somebody was seizing in B5 and he gave 7 or 8 milligrams altogether, boom, like that. And of course the patient stopped breathing and they had called the code blue. So start slow, okay? Give 2 milligrams, let's say, and then, I mean, if you have somebody who, for instance, is alcoholic and you know that for sure, then you may go a bit higher doses if you want. But you can use the diazepam. There are some advantages. If you don't have any access, you can give it rectally, for instance. Or you can use midazolam, and then you go to the stage that you need to start thinking about some second agent, so second line of defense, and you use the same idea, phenytoin, fosphenytoin, valproic acid, or levetiracetam. You're not going to use carbamazepine because it will take you forever to reach levels or give it through the gut for somebody who's seizing actively, okay, or has a long seizure. When you have a seizure up to, between 1 and 5 minutes, you don't know if the patient will stop or will go to status, because the definition of status these days is what? 5 minutes of continuous seizing. It's not 30 minutes as we had it before. So if you seize for, if you're convulsing for 5 minutes, this is considered status. So again, seizure precautions. What about if the seizure continue? What are you gonna do in this situation? Well, you don't have too many choices there. Probably you will intubate the patient if you have already done that before. And sometimes you intubate them even before you give lorazepam, because they don't protect the airway. They're biting the tongue, they're bleeding from the mouth, they're desaturating. So maybe at some point you had already intubated. But if you haven't done that, you go and you intubate them, and then you go to general anesthetics. So you can use propofol, you can use thiopental. I don't know if we still have it here. It was fun to prepare it, because you have to take the syringes there and put them together. Or you can use midazolam, which we do have. And we have it in the ICUs all the time, so you can give them this one or that one, usually. And you need to be ready to support them hemodynamically, because, as you know, both of them, especially the propofol in high doses, 2 milligrams per kilogram, we're talking about a big dose, anesthetic dose, then will drop your blood pressure. So you need to have at least, if you tell the nurse, give me, 2 milligrams in a 70, 140 milligrams of propofol, then you need to tell her also bring a bag of Neo and bring a bag of fluids, because the blood pressure will go all the way down. And if you also call for a continuous EEG in this case, and you hook the patient to a continuous EEG, and then you see what happens there. If you have seizures, continuous seizures, in a patient who's already on general anesthetics, that's really bad. That sucks. So that means that you have a really refractory status, or maybe a super refractory status, and then you have two options there. Either you give higher levels, higher infusion rates of these medications, or you go to pentobarbital, or we have some other options I'm going to show you in the next slide. So probably at that time it would be a good idea to call me and maybe for us to take this patient upstairs or laterally, the same floor. So pentobarbital, how are you going to do it? I mean, you're going to load them with 10, 12 milligrams per kilogram, and then you can start an infusion, and I think in this hospital we can go up to 5 milligrams per kilogram per hour, and this should be done with a continuous EEG. And what would be your goal? Nobody knows, but some people go for stopping the seizures, so the goal is to stop the seizures on the continuous EEG, and some others go for burst suppression with flat EEG. I don't have a slide to show you. I think you've seen that what means burst suppression. You have some bursts, and then there's a flat line, and then you have bursts again. So some people believe that the longer the suppression, the longer the flat line, so the higher the doses of these medications, the better chances that this patient will emerge out of it. I don't think that's necessarily the case. And these are bad medications, because what happens with barbiturates, if you put somebody on barbiturate coma? First, you lose the exam. So you don't know if the patient is brain dead. I mean, the pupils are non-reactive, there is no corneal, there is no movement, they are flaccid, they are on pressors. The myocardium doesn't contract very well. The gut stops working, so some of these patients will go to TPN. You don't have ciliary action in the trachea and the bronchi, so stuff stay inside and you need to suction them vigorously and do chest PT, because otherwise you will develop atelectasis and pneumonia. And then obviously also something that people don't know is there are some studies that show that the immune system of these patients goes down with the barbiturates. So there are some studies, I didn't put slides just for brevity, but there are some studies, recent studies, one from Hopkins and some others from Europe actually, that show that they try to prove actually that if you put them on barbiturate coma, then the outcome is bad and is an independent predictor, the barbiturate coma. I don't think that that's necessarily true, because it is just a bad disease that the patient has. So if these seizures continue, or you try to emerge them from the pentobarbital coma and the patient continues seizing, then you call it super refractory status, and then over there you can do whatever you want. It's the Wild West, okay? So you can use ketamine, and actually we have now, I changed the slide, because we had it up to 5 milligrams per kilogram per hour, but according to my pharmacist, now we can use it up to 10 milligrams per kilogram per hour. If you have somebody who has porphyria, you're not going to use any of these nice anti-epileptic medications, hepatic metabolize. You're going to use general anesthetics from the OR, I guess. How many times have you used in the medical ICU Flurane? Nobody. I don't think so. But you can use topiramate in high doses. Don't forget it gives you a non-anion gap metabolic acidosis, because it's a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. You can use high doses of magnesium. Again, are there any data about that? My voodoo is to give high doses of pyridoxine, B6, because it is a cofactor for GABA generation, which is the inhibitory. And then you go to this situation that, you don't know why this patient is seizing. This is probably NORS, which is new onset refractory status epilepticus. Then there are two major etiologies. Either you have paraneoplastic or autoimmune disorders, non-MDA receptor, for instance, encephalitis, or GABA-B antibody encephalitis. Or you can have encephalitis, viral encephalitis, and you can do NLP, and you can find the viruses. You know, you can find, let's say, herpes, or you won't find anything, as you know. You do the LP, and you send for arboviruses, and you have probably 30%, 40% chances to find the virus in a situation like that. So what are you going to do in this situation? If you send the paraneoplastic workup out, it will take, 2 weeks? 3 weeks. So during that period of time, what are you going to do with this patient? Will it be seizing? No. So right now the trend that everybody has and is doing is to start this patient high-dose steroids. Again, these are very sick patients, not necessarily to get a huge super mega dose of solumetrol. Or you can start them on IVIG, or you can plasmapherese them. So you can call Dr. Lopez, and she'll be glad probably to plasmapherese these patients. So we had a study that we were doing before with hypothermia, but it was like a few months ago in New England Journal. I don't know if you saw it. It's called Hibernatus study that they used it in Europe, and it did not show any benefit. So we are not using hypothermia anymore. Another failure of hypothermia. I mean, in any JAMA that I read or anything else, hypothermia doesn't work in this. Hypothermia doesn't work in that. But anyway. You can use ketogenic diet, and then you go to strange and crazy things like electroconvulsive therapy, do ECT in these patients. One of my colleagues just across the street, in another reputable institution, used the paddles in a patient's head, and Jody stopped him, my nurse practitioner. So yeah, you can use whatever you want. And some of these patients do not come out. And there have been described cases that this patient was seizing for 9 months, and the family eventually withdrew life support. Okay, these are usually bad encephalitides from viruses, or maybe undetected paraneoplastic stuff. Which, by the way, I don't know. Do you have any recent lecture about paraneoplastic encephalitis or autoimmune encephalitis? If not, that's an interesting thing, because you see these patients. And we had probably two or three patients from you upstairs. And there are so many now. I did go to Boston, it was the AAN, the American Academy of Neurology, and I did go to one of these presentations by a guy named Dalmau, who's the world expert on this. And I was surprised, because you know I knew probably 10 or 15 of them, you know, they list in my mind, and they had presented probably 30. So every single day there is a new one that's coming out. And we don't know. So, in the ICU, you have low albumin, and there are some medications, some antiepileptics that are very albumin linked. So you need to check free levels in these patients, because you can have a total level that is low, but the free level may be therapeutic or high. If you have patients with phenobarbital, don't forget that it's dialyzable. So if they are on RRT, then you need to replace it after the dialysis. And if you have some patients who have SIDH, it's not a good idea to use drugs that give you SIDH, like carbamazepine and oxcarbamazepine. Okay? And of course, you have the big question is in the ICU, with super many drugs, you have interaction with many other drugs. So what are these interactions? So these are the anti-epileptic medications that you have. And as you can see, right now we have many. We are very happy about that. And then you add another anti-epileptic medication. And what happens here, you have all these interactions. Usually, they are inducers, except for the valproic acid that is an inhibitor. So as you can see, it raises, if you add it, it raises the levels of phenobarbital, of benzodiazepines, etc., etc. So why am I showing you this? Because of this exactly point. Oops, didn't work very well. So if you look at this part of the screen, then you have many interactions. But if you look at this part of the screen, you don't have so many. And this is because here you have newer anti-epileptic medications, and from here on you have newer anti-epileptic medications. So the newer ones don't interact very much with each other. Okay? So they are more expensive, usually, but clearly in an ICU environment when you have multi-drugs, then probably they are better because they have fewer interactions, at least with the anti-epileptic medications. And I put this again, medication that we use in the neuro ICU, I don't know if you use statins in your unit, or nimodipine, how the addition of anti-epileptic medication, the classical ones, affects them. And as you can see, again, the valproic is increasing the levels. What about other medications in the ICU? Again, you have the anti-epileptic medications, and then you add another drug here, and what will happen to these anti-epileptic medications? Again, don't forget that the amiodarone and phenytoin don't go together. They don't like each other. So if you have somebody on both of them, you need to check levels more frequently. And as I showed you before, if you have valproic acid and ertapenem, carbapenems, then you need to be careful because it lowers the levels of these drugs. And again, the same idea, if you look at the newer anti-epileptic medications compared to the older ones, you can see that you have many more interactions with medication that you have or you use maybe in the ICU compared to that area with the newer anti-epileptics. You don't have too many. So again, if you have a choice, use the newer ones. So that's all, folks. Thank you. And if you have any questions.
Yes. I have a question regarding management of status. So in the emergency department, we obviously have a lot of patients that come in status, and we treat them with the usual Ativan, 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 or Versed, Versed, Versed. We intubate them, and we start them on, often either if somebody's taking Darlantin or Keppra as their initial anti-epileptic agent to treat. Mm-hmm. How long do you wait after you administer your anti-epileptic to decide to start a second AED and not just keep giving them benzos?
That's a great question. So if
they
you
always got pharmacies like, just wait to see if this will work, and I'm like, how long? What are you like? How, what time frame?
I think you should go the so the lines of defense is benzos, lorazepam, in essence, these days, and you can go and reach the level that we the dose that which is maximum 0.1 milligrams per kilogram. Of course, if the patient is intubated already, because around 21% of them in the Rampart study that we did were intubated before even coming to the hospital. So if you have, if the airway is protected and the patient is seizing in front of you, you can use higher doses. You can use 0.2 milligrams, whatever. But if the patient is not intubated, then I would, as I told you, I would give the maximum dose watching the patient. Then if the patient is clinically seizing, convulsing, then I will go immediately. I won't wait. But the question that I have for you is, and I'll show you some data, is that even if the patient stops seizing, stop convulsing, you don't know if the brain is seizing. So the question is, how fast can you do an EEG in this hospital or in other reputed institutions?
What time of day is it?
That's a great question. So, for instance, if you are in California and if you are in San Bernardino, for instance, where a friend of mine is, then he developed this cask. In essence, you just wear it, and it has electrodes, and the techs just, even the nurses in the ER can go and just put the leads. You have the EEG next door. So you don't need the techs necessarily to do it. But you need to have a continuous EEG in order to be sure. Of course, if the patient, you give the lorazepam, and the patient wakes up and follows commands, you know that most probably the patient is not seizing. But it doesn't happen, because for a certain period of time, you don't know if it is the benzo that has sedated the patient or it is that the brain is seizing. So you need the continuous EEG, and if there is nothing, just benzo activity, beta activity on the continuous EEG or the EEG, then you know that the patient is not seizing. But without that, you don't know. Don't wait, because status definition is 5 minutes. So clearly, if you have somebody who's seizing and doesn't respond to the first line of defense, give the ones that you just mentioned, phenytoin, levetiracetam, etc., and then go directly to general anesthetics. I mean, by that time, the patient would be probably intubated, or intubate them at that time, and then go to propofol or midazolam. And usually that stops everything. If they seize on midazolam, what was the highest that we got a transfer from, you remember the dose? It was a huge dose. It was like a huge dose of midazolam. It was like 200 milligrams or something like that. Don't forget that midazolam, has a propylene glucose also. So you need to be careful with these things. Okay, so thank you.